Let's start with a blessing for the Lord. Music is a prayer language, for those who don't realize it. And a lot of the music that we do is just that, it's prayers. It's prayers put to a melody, put to a rhythm. What happens with music is when you learn a song, you've really learned something. We don't forget songs that we've really learned. I mean, how many of you remember the nursery rhymes you learned as songs when you were kids? You know, if I start one, you'll finish it. And God knows how our brain is set. And so we've got some prayers that we set to music, and we're going to go ahead and start with Bless the Lord, O my soul. See if my voice warms up, which I haven't done any of that yet.
Bless the Lord.
we are here in this house to worship you, to honor you, to glorify you. We are here because it is good to be in your house. We are here, Father, because you have called us and you delight in us and you have desired to honor us. Lord, we come to you because we want to be like you, because you are such a good God. Yeah, let's do it. We'll be doing it tonight, but we'll do it anyway. Blessed are you, O Lord our God.
Sabbath candles. We can sing at any time. Blessed.
say, it's all about him. It's not about how I think. It's all about him. Let's do the chorus again. Lie, lie, lie.
Thank you.
stand for the blessings, for the reading of the Shema, the sounding of the shofar. Where did it go? Oh, there it is. Where did my prayer shawl go? There it is. If anyone does want a prayer shawl to use, we have one here. We have scarves if women want to use those instead. We typically cover our heads because of reverence. It's not required. It's not necessary in this house. We follow the Spirit's lead, and if the Spirit says cover, cover. If he doesn't, don't worry about it. But many of us do. It's a way of honoring him, a way of saying blessing to him.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Baruch Shem Kevod Malkuto Leolom Vayed. Blessed be the name of the glory of his kingdom forever and ever. Vahavta et Adonai Elohecha bechor lavavecha uvchor nafshecha uvchor meldecha. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. V'hayu hadvarim hayala asher anoki misvachcha hayom alavavecha. And these words which I command you today shall be upon your hearts. V'shinantam levanecha v'debarta bam bevshecha bevtecha uvlecha v'erech uvshakbecha uvkameka. You shall teach them thoroughly to your children, and you shall speak of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk on the road, when you lie down, and when you rise. Ukshatam leolot ayadeka v'hayu letotafot bin inecha. You shall bind them as a sign upon your hand, and they shall be for a reminder between your eyes. Uktavtam el muzozot beteka uvisharecha. And you shall write them upon the doorposts of your house and upon your gates.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam, asher kirshanu b'torcha v'natan lanu ervor ha'chaim b'yeshua mishachenu, sar ha'shalom. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with your Torah and has given us the light of life in Jesus, our Messiah, the Prince of Peace. To the God of restoration. Stand, sit, worship, use the instruments, use the flags. You feel free to participate in this house.
Hallelujah.
God who hears. He's the God who keeps Israel, for he is Shomer, the keeper of Israel. Thank you. Torah reading today. Today's reading is out of a part that we often, you know, in Christian circles, it often gets skipped, which is really sad. Because what that says is that we just kind of, you know, don't understand it. If that makes any sense. We are beginning the book of Leviticus. Just as we are beginning the new month, which is the beginning of the liturgical year or the beginning of the months of celebration at the beginning. We're starting the book of Leviticus, chapter 1, verse 1. And in our Bibles, we're reading through to 6, verse 7, if you're reading it out of a standard Bible. If you're reading out of a Hebrew Bible, it would be 520, the end of chapter 5 or 526. Quite often, all the markings are a little bit different. Most of the time, they're pretty much the same. But there are times it's different. We're going to be reading about, you know, the sacrifices. We're going to be reading about all of that. The translation of Leviticus to the word Leviticus, it's the Latin, and what it means is to the Levites. And the assumption is made that this is all instruction to the Levites in the temple. But that couldn't be farther from the truth. Although there's instruction for the Levites in this book, it really is more of Vayikra, which comes from the very first word where it says, and the Lord called to Moses. It's about the calling of God and coming near to him.
Chapter again? Leviticus chapter 1 through 6. Then the Lord called to Moses and spoke to him from the tent of meeting, saying, speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, when any man of you brings an offering to the Lord, you shall bring your offering of animals from the herd or the flock. If his offering is a burnt offering from the herd, he shall offer it, a male without defect. He shall offer it at the doorway of the tent of meeting, that he may be accepted before the Lord. And he shall lay his hand on the head of the burnt offering, that it may be accepted for him to make atonement on his behalf. And he shall slay the young bull before the Lord, and Aaron's sons, the priests, shall offer up the blood and sprinkle the blood around on the altar that is at the doorway of the tent of meeting. He shall then skin the burnt offering and cut it into its pieces. And the sons of Aaron, the priests, shall put fire on the altar and arrange wood on the fire. Then Aaron's sons, the priests, shall arrange the pieces, the head and the suet over the wood which is on the fire that is on the altar. Its entrails, however, and its legs he shall wash with water, and the priest shall offer up in smoke all of it on the altar for a burnt offering, an offering by fire of a soothing aroma to the Lord. But if his offering is from the flock, of the sheep, or of the goats for a burnt offering, he shall offer it a male without defect. And he shall slay it on the side of the altar northward before the Lord, and Aaron's sons, the priests, shall sprinkle its blood around on the altar. He shall then cut it into its pieces with its head and its suet, and the priest shall arrange them on the wood which is on the fire that is on the altar. The entrails, however, and the legs he shall wash with water, and the priest shall offer all of it, and offer it up in smoke on the altar. It is a burnt offering, an offering by fire of a soothing aroma to the Lord. But if his offering to the Lord is a burnt offering of birds, then he shall bring his offering from the turtle doves or from young pigeons. And the priest shall bring it to the altar and wring off its head and offer it up in smoke on the altar, and its blood is to be drained out on the side of the altar. He shall also take away its crop with its feathers and cast it beside the altar eastward to the place of the ashes. Then he shall tear it by its wings, but shall not sever it. And the priest shall offer it up in smoke on the altar, on the wood which is on the fire. It is a burnt offering, an offering by fire of a soothing aroma to the Lord. Now when anyone presents a grain offering as an offering to the Lord, his offering shall be of fine flour, and he shall pour oil on it and put frankincense on it. He shall then bring it to Aaron's sons, the priests, and shall take from it his handful of its fine flour and of its oil with all of its frankincense, and the priest shall offer it up in smoke as a memorial, as its memorial portion on the altar, as an offering by fire of a soothing aroma to the Lord. And the remainder of the grain offering belongs to Aaron and his sons, a thing most holy, of the offerings to the Lord by fire. Now when you bring an offering of a grain offering baked in an oven, it shall be unleavened cakes of fine flour mixed with oil, or unleavened wafers spread with oil. And if your offering is a grain offering made on the griddle, it shall be of fine flour, unleavened, mixed with oil. You shall break it into bits and pour oil on it. It is a grain offering. Now if your offering is a grain offering made in a pan, it shall be made of fine flour filled. It shall be made of fine flour with oil. When you bring in the grain offering which is made of these things to the Lord, it shall be presented to the priest, and he shall bring it to the altar. The priest shall then take up from the grain offering its memorial portion, and shall offer it up in smoke on the altar as an offering by fire of a soothing aroma to the Lord. And the remainder of the grain offering belongs to Aaron and his sons, a thing most holy, of the offerings to the Lord by fire. No grain offering which you bring to the Lord shall be made with leaven, for you shall not offer up in smoke any leaven or any honey as an offering by fire to the Lord. As an offering of first fruits, you shall bring them to the Lord, but they shall not ascend for a soothing aroma on the altar. Every grain offering of yours, moreover, you shall season with salt, so that the salt of the covenant of your God shall not be lacking from your grain offering. With all of your offerings, you shall offer salt. Also, if you bring a grain offering of early ripened things to the Lord, you shall bring fresh heads of grain roasted in the fire, grits of new growth for the grain offering of your early ripened things. You shall then put oil on it and lay incense on it. It is a grain offering. And the priest shall offer up in smoke its memorial portion, part of its grits and its oil with all its incense, as an offering by fire to the Lord. Now if his offering is a sacrifice of peace offerings, if he is going to offer out of the herd, whether male or female, he shall offer it without defect before the Lord. And he shall lay his hand on the head of his offering and slay it at the doorway of the tent of meeting. And Aaron's sons, the priests, shall sprinkle the blood around on the altar. And from the sacrifice of the peace offerings, he shall present an offering by fire to the Lord, the fat that covers the entrails and all the fat that is on the entrails, and the two kidneys with the fat that is on them, which is on the loins and the lobe of the liver, which he shall remove with the kidneys. Then Aaron's sons shall offer it up in smoke on the altar on the burnt offering, which is on the wood that is on the fire. It is an offering by fire of a soothing aroma to the Lord. But if his offering for a sacrifice of peace offerings to the Lord is from the flock, he shall offer it, male or female, without defect. If he is going to offer a lamb for his offering, then he shall offer it before the Lord, and he shall lay his hand on the head of his offering and slay it before the tent of meeting, and Aaron's sons shall sprinkle its blood around on the altar. And from the sacrifice of peace offerings he shall bring as an offering by fire to the Lord its fat, the entire fat tail, which he shall remove close to the backbone, and the fat that covers the entrails, and all the fat that is on the entrails, and the two kidneys with the fat that is on them, which is on the loins, and the lobe of the liver, which he shall remove with the kidneys. Then the priest shall offer it up in smoke on the altar as food, an offering by fire to the Lord. Moreover, if his offering is a goat, Then he shall offer it before the Lord, and he shall lay his hand on its head, and slay it before the tent of meeting, and the sons of Aaron shall sprinkle its blood around on the altar. And from it he shall present his offering as an offering by fire to the Lord, the fat that covers the entrails, and all the fat that is on the entrails, and the two kidneys with the fat that is on them, which is on the loins, and the lobe of the liver, which he shall remove with the kidneys. And the priest shall offer them up in smoke on the altar as food, an offering by fire for a soothing aroma. All fat is the Lord's. It is a perpetual statute throughout your generations and all your dwellings. You shall not eat any fat or any blood. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Speak to the sons of Israel, saying, If a person sins unintentionally in any of the things which the Lord has commanded not to be done, and commits any of them, if the anointed priest sins so as to bring guilt on the people, then let him offer to the Lord a bull without defect, as a sin offering for the sin he has committed. And he shall bring the bull to the doorway of the tent of meeting before the Lord, and he shall lay his hand on the head of the bull, and slay the bull before the Lord. Then the anointed priest is to take some of the blood of the bull and bring it to the tent of meeting. And the priest shall dip his finger in the blood and sprinkle some of the blood seven times before the Lord in front of the veil of the sanctuary. The priest shall also put some of the blood on the horns of the altar of fragrant incense, which is before the Lord in the tent of meeting, and all the blood of the bull he shall pour out at the base of the altar of burnt offering, which is at the doorway of the tent of meeting. And he shall remove from it all the fat of the bull of the sin offering, the fat that covers the entrails, and all the fat which is on the entrails, and the two kidneys with the fat that is on them, which is on the loins, and the lobe of the liver, which he shall remove with the kidneys, just as it is removed from the ox of the sacrifice of peace offerings. And the priest is to offer them up in smoke on the altar of burnt offering. But the hide of the bull and all its flesh, with its head and its legs and its entrails and its refuse, that is, all the rest of the bull, he is to bring out to a clean place outside the camp where the ashes are poured out, and burn it on wood with fire where the ashes are poured out, it shall be burned. Now if the whole congregation of Israel commits error, and the matter escapes the notice of the assembly, and they commit any of the things which the Lord has commanded not to be done, and they become guilty, when the sin which they have committed becomes known, then the assembly shall offer a bull of the herd for a sin offering, and bring it before the tent of meeting. Then the elders of the congregation shall lay their hands on the head of the bull before the Lord, and the bull shall be slain before the Lord. Then the anointed priest is to bring some of the blood of the bull to the tent of meeting, and the priest shall dip his finger in the blood, sprinkle it seven times before the Lord in front of the veil. And he shall put some of the blood on the horns of the altar which is before the Lord in the tent of meeting, and all the blood he shall pour out at the base of the altar of burnt offering which is at the doorway of the tent of meeting. And he shall remove all its fat from it, and offer it up in smoke on the altar. He shall also do with the bull just as he did with the bull of the sin offering, thus he shall do with it. So the priest shall make atonement for them, and they shall be forgiven. Then he is to bring out the bull to a place outside the camp, and burn it as he burned the first bull. It is the sin offering for the assembly. When a leader sins and unintentionally does any one of all the things which the Lord God has commanded not to be done, and he becomes guilty, if his sin which he has committed is made known to him, he shall bring for his offering a goat, a male without defect, and he shall lay his hand on the head of the male goat and slay it in the place where they slay the burnt offering before the Lord. It is a sin offering. Then the priest is to take some of the blood of the sin offering with his finger and put it on the horns of the altar of burnt offering, and the rest of its blood he shall pour out at the base of the altar of burnt offering. And all its fat shall be And all its fat he shall offer up in smoke on the altar, as in the case of the fat of the sacrifice of peace offerings. Thus the priest shall make atonement for him in regard to his sin, and he shall be forgiven. Now if any one of the common people sins unintentionally in doing any of the things which the Lord has commanded not to be done, and becomes guilty, if his sin which he has committed is made known to him, then he shall bring for his offering a goat, a female without defect, for his sin which he has committed. And he shall lay his hand on the head of the sin offering, and slay the sin offering at the place of the burnt offering. And the priest shall take some of its blood with his finger, and put it on the horns of the altar of burnt offering, and all the rest of its blood he shall pour out at the base of the altar. Then he shall remove all its fat, just as the fat was removed from the sacrifice of peace offerings. And the priest shall offer it up in smoke on the altar for a soothing aroma to the Lord. Thus the priest shall make atonement for him, and he shall be forgiven. But if he brings a lamb as his offering for a sin offering, he shall bring it, a female without defect, and he shall lay his hand on the head of the sin offering, and slay it for a sin offering in the place where they slay the burnt offering. And the priest is to take some of the blood of the sin offering with his finger and put it on the horns of the altar of burnt offering, and all the rest of its blood he shall pour out at the base of the altar. Then he shall remove all its fat, just as the fat of the lamb is removed from the sacrifice of the peace offerings, and the priest shall offer them up in smoke on the altar, on the offerings by fire to the Lord. Thus the priest shall make atonement for him in regard to his sin, which he has committed, and he shall be forgiven. Now if a person sins after he hears a public adjuration to testify when he is a witness, whether he has seen or otherwise known, if he does not tell it, then he will bear his guilt. Or if a person touches any unclean thing, whether a carcass or of an unclean beast, or the carcass of an unclean cattle, or a carcass of unclean swarming things, though it is hidden from him, and he is unclean, then he will be guilty. Or if he touches human uncleanness, of whatever sort his uncleanness may be, with which he becomes unclean, and it is hidden from him, and he comes to know it, he will be guilty. Or if a person swears thoughtlessly with his lips to do evil or to do good, in whatever matter a man may speak thoughtlessly with an oath, and it is hidden from him, and then he comes to know it, he will be guilty in one of these. So it shall be when he becomes guilty in one of these, that he shall confess that in which he has sinned. He shall also bring his guilt offering to the Lord for his sin which he has committed, a female from the flock, a lamb or a goat as a sin offering. So the priest shall make atonement on his behalf for his sin. But if he cannot afford a lamb, then he shall bring to the Lord his guilt offering for that which he has sinned, 2 turtle doves or 2 young pigeons, one for a sin offering and the other for a burnt offering. And he shall bring them to the priest, who shall offer first that which is for the sin offering, and shall nip its head at the front of its neck, but he shall not sever it. He shall also sprinkle some of the blood of the sin offering on the side of the altar, while the rest of the blood shall be drained out at the base of the altar. It is a sin offering. The second he shall then prepare as a burnt offering, according to the ordinance. So the priest shall make atonement on his behalf for his sin which he has committed, and it shall be forgiven him. But if his means are insufficient for 2 turtle doves or 2 young pigeons, then for his offering for that which he has sinned, he shall bring the 10th of an ephah of fine flour for a sin offering. He shall not put oil on it or place incense on it, for it is a sin offering. And he shall bring it to the priest, and the priest shall take his handful of it as its memorial portion, and offer it up in smoke on the altar with the offerings of the Lord by fire. It is a sin offering. So the priest shall make atonement for him, concerning his sin which he has committed from one of these, and it shall be forgiven him. The rest shall become the priest's, like the grain offering.
Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, If a person acts unfaithfully and sins unintentionally against the Lord's holy things, then he shall bring his guilt offering to the Lord, a ram without defect from the flock, according to your valuation in silver by shekels, in terms of the shekel of the sanctuary, for a guilt offering. And he shall make restitution for that which he has sinned. And he shall make restitution for that which he has sinned against the holy thing, and he shall add to it a fifth part of it, and give it to the priest. The priest shall then make atonement for him with the ram of the guilt offering, and it shall be forgiven him. Now if a person sins and does any of the things which the Lord has commanded not to be done, though he was unaware, still he is guilty and shall bear his punishment. He is then to bring to the priest a ram without defect from the flock, according to your valuation, for a guilt offering. So the priest shall make atonement for him concerning his error in which he sinned unintentionally and did not know it, and it shall be forgiven him. It is a guilt offering. He was certainly guilty before the Lord. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, When a person sins and acts unfaithfully against the Lord and deceives his companion in regard to a deposit or a security entrusted to him, or through robbery, or if he has extorted from his companion, or has found what was lost and lied about it and sworn falsely, so that he sins in regard to any of it, any one of the things a man may do. I'm going to start that verse again. Or has found what was lost and lied about it and sworn falsely so that he sins in regard to any one of the things a man may do, then it shall be when he sins and becomes guilty that he shall restore what he took by robbery or what he got by extortion or the deposit which was entrusted to him or the lost thing which he found or anything about which he swore falsely. He shall make restitution for it in full and add to it one-fifth more. He shall give it to the one to whom it belongs on the day he presents his guilt offering. And then he shall bring to the priest his guilt offering to the Lord, a ram without defect from the flock, according to your valuation, for a guilt offering. And the priest shall make atonement for him before the Lord, and he shall be forgiven for any one of the things which he may have done to incur guilt.
Close. Just cry. Congregations, as I visit around, especially in the congregations of the Sunday-going Christians, as I visit around, I hear an awful lot of God come, God come, God come, God come. We want God to come, and we want God's presence to be with us, and we want the Shekinah glory of God. My question is, do we really? And the reason I ask that is because do we have any concept of what it really costs to host the Shekinah glory of God? I'm not talking about the Holy Spirit dwelling in our bodies, okay? The Holy Spirit dwells within us. God has told us, He has given us a deposit of our salvation in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is part of us because He has become that, because God has made that so. I'm not talking about a sensation of the presence of God where the air is kind of thick and it's a little heavy and we know God's here. I'm talking about the pure, unadulterated Shekinah glory of God as it rested on the temple. Do we have any clue what it costs? As soon as sin entered the world, what was the first thing Adam and Eve did? When they recognized that they had transgressed, when they recognized they had violated the one command God had given them, that was a do not command. And He'd given them other commands, by the way. They had other instructions. They were supposed to till the garden. They were supposed to take care of the garden. They were supposed to protect the garden. They were supposed to enjoy the garden. Those were commands of God also. But what's the one He said don't do? And what's the first thing they did when they realized the severity of violating that command? They hid from God. Why did they hide from God?
They were scared.
They were scared. Why would they be scared? Because you know what? This mortal body cannot handle the immortality of God. As soon as they violated it, they lost their immortality. And they began to die. And death entered the world. God told them, on the day you eat of it, you'll die. Progressive die, not once and for all die. Sometimes we miss that because we don't read it in the Hebrew, okay? Right. On the day you eat of it, you begin to die. And they knew it, and they hid. Why did they hide? Because God is powerful. When Abraham was 99 and he appeared to God to tell him that he was going to enter into this covenant, what happened with God? Did Abraham run out and shout hallelujah? In Genesis 17, verses 1 through 3, we find out that no, Abram, who walked with God, right? Abram, who knew God, Abram, who was God's friend, fell on his face before God. He couldn't stand. When God descended on Mount Sinai to give the Ten Commandments, do you remember that? Not too long ago, we read about that in Exodus, and we read about the cloud covering the mountain, and we read about the lightning, and the voice says, it says it hurts thunder and lightning, but in the Hebrew, that word thunder represents voices. They heard the voices, they heard the light, they saw the lightning. They saw the power of God. The mountain was quaking. And what did the people say? Moses, you go talk to him. We're afraid. He scares me. He scares me. And even Moses, when he asked to see God, what happened with him? God had to hide him in the cleft of a rock to keep him from being killed. Just by the presence of God. It's not that God wants to kill. Don't get that concept. I know there are people who have that concept. God loves blood. No, he doesn't. He hates death. He hates death. He hates death. He hates death. He does not revel in it. He does not enjoy it. But there is this place that our mortal bodies cannot stand in the presence of God. When Joshua is confronted by the commander of the army of the Lord, as he thought about how he was supposed to go into the land, how he was supposed to do that, did Joshua salute this angel? Did Joshua shake his hand? No. This was the captain of the armies of the Lord showing himself in the splendor of that glory of it. And Joshua fell on his face in Joshua chapter 5, verses 13 through 14, if you want to look it up. When Ezekiel saw the Lord, yes, people have seen the Lord, by the way, but never in his fullness. To see him in his fullness would die. When Ezekiel saw the Lord in Ezekiel chapter 1, beginning with verse 4, and it goes all through the 28, and Ezekiel saw the Lord. I mean, he writes this beautiful, beautiful vision of God, but it says he fell on his face trembling. And then, of course, there's Isaiah, and we sang a song that's based out of that chapter in Isaiah. And it's based on Isaiah's response, and I'm just going to read it to you. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne high and lifted up, and his train of his robe filled the temple. And above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face. With two he covered his feet. With two he flew. And one would cry out to the other and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called. And the house was filled with smoke. And I said, did he say, "Yay, hallelujah, I'm going to jump up and down and be excited"? Did he wave flags? Did he clap his hands? No, it says, I said, "Woe is me. Oh, God, please help. I'm in trouble. Woe is me. I am a man of unclean lips. And I dwell amongst a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King." I'm going to die. You can translate it that way easily. I'm going to die. I see the King. Oh, my. Do we have anywhere written that Isaiah was a heavy sinner? Do we have anywhere written that Ezekiel sinned? We don't have any record of any of their sins, by the way. We have a record of Abram walking with God, and he still fell on his face. Moses still had to be hidden in the cleft of the rock. And when Moses went to the burning bush, he fell on his face there. Do we really want, can we really handle the presence of God? Not without protection. We can't. And it doesn't stop in the Old Testament that way, by the way. It doesn't stop in the Torah, in the Tanakh. It goes on. And in the apostolic writings, the writings of the apostles, as they put it down for us to understand today, we have Peter, when he sees Yeshua coming out of the, and he comes out of the, you know, remember when Simon Peter, they'd been fishing all night and they didn't catch anything, and Yeshua told him, "Put your nets on the other side. Violate your normal pattern here. Let's do something different. I'm going to tell you to do something different." And they cast their nets on the other side, and they almost couldn't get the fish up because the nets were going to break because there was so much. And when Simon Peter saw it, he fell on his knees and he says, "Get away from me. I'm a sinful man. Lord, get away from me." The first thing Peter does when he realizes who this is and the power of God on this man was to fall down and say, I'm in trouble. John, the apostle that Jesus loved, when he sees him in his glory. Now remember, John is the one who leaned on his breast at the Passover dinner, at the last Seder, at that last time. John's the one that was always next to him, right next to him. He was his bosom buddy. There's a reason for that phrase. They were close. John, when he sees him in his glory in Revelation 1:17, falls down as if he were dead. Are we ready to do that? Do we want the glory of God? See, if we really want the glory of God, there's a price to be paid for it. In the book of Leviticus, as we began reading, we sometimes look at this as just instructions for the Old Testament. These are instructions for the tabernacle. You know what they are? They're instructions for God's Shekinah glory to be able to dwell with people, to be able to be in a physical place on the physical earth. These are instructions for purifying the temple and keeping that place pure. You know, sometimes we look at this and we think it's all about us. It's all about keeping us clean, right? It's all about that man's sin being forgiven. Well, what sin is he really committing that's being forgiven here? He's coming to the presence of God as a human being who carries death, who carries the picture of death. Have you ever felt like, and I have felt this way, you know, particularly when I've not been walking right or whatever, feel like everything you touch you make dirty. Just doesn't feel right. I don't want to do that because it. Well, guess what? Everything we touch we make dirty. It's reality. Why? Because we are infected with the disease called death. Because we live in a land, on a world that has been filled with the pollution that sin brings, and that pollution is death, and we are all in it. Mm-hmm. We can't help it. We inherited that. We inherited that in the natural. The book of Leviticus is about making a place where the Shekinah glory can dwell safely among men, where our sin, our defiling of the temple, our touching these things is cleansed. Do they ever take the blood and put it on the person? Did you read that? Did you notice that? This is not about cleansing the person. This is a big, you know, I've read several, I study a lot trying to get this where we can understand it. And I've read all kinds of passages that talk about how this is a picture of Yeshua's sacrifice for us. It cleans the person. The person's no longer... when I read this and I look at it, he doesn't apply the blood to the person, does he? He applies the blood to the horn of the altar. He pours the blood out at the base of the altar. This isn't about us as individuals, except that if we want to draw near to God, where we draw near to Him, we contaminate because of death. And so we bring an offering. I don't want to contaminate this, Lord. I know that's a really different way of looking at this. It's unusual. It's not the norm. If you don't agree, don't worry about it. Study it out. Yes, there's a place. This is extremely personal. It is about me as a person. We have this idea. By the way, I always had the idea that a person brought the lamb or the goat or the bull or whatever it was and handed it to the priest. The priest takes it off and the priest slits the throat and all that, right? That was the idea I had growing up. That's not what happens. You bring your offering. You lay your hand on the offering. And with the priest standing there, you slit the throat of that animal. priest doesn't do that for you. That's a different thought, isn't it? I'm a city girl born and raised. I was born and raised in Phoenix. Now, my dad was a country boy. He was a farmer's son. He liked the idea of understanding life and death and all of that stuff, and he thought his kids needed to do that. He planted a garden in the backyard in the middle of Phoenix. We had a pet goat, and I do mean a pet, a couple of them actually. We used to walk one of them on a leash. He was an Angora goat, and Dad had had him trimmed to look like a standard-sized poodle, and we'd walk the goat on a leash around the neighborhood, and people would go, "That poodle has horns." I mean, he had a real weird sense of humor. But here's how my dad ended up with the goat, because my dad had asked. He wanted to learn about lambs. And he had asked a Navajo pastor from the Tuba City area to bring him a lamb. He wanted his children, he wanted the church to learn about lambs and what it's like to raise a lamb and love a lamb. And I think he had the idea he was going to sacrifice that lamb or butcher it, and we'd have roast lamb, which is, by the way, very good when it's done fresh. But that wasn't what happened. The pastor brought him this goat. And he said, "Pastor Darby, I brought you a goat." My dad's looking at him going, "I wanted a lamb." He goes, "Yeah, but I know the people you pastor. You need to learn about goats." It became a standard joke. It was kind of one of those joke things, because we are more like goats a lot of times, aren't we? We get rebellious. And we learned a lot about goats. My dad, we raised chickens. Why? So we could butcher chickens. He even did it with rabbits at one point, and there was about 2 months where I wouldn't eat any meat at all, because we realized we'd had dinner and one of the rabbits was gone, and was it the rabbit, you know? My dad taught us, we understood. Meat comes from an animal, right? It's not like, and I don't know if you've read this story, but I've seen it to be somewhat true in people today raised in cities, especially not in rural areas like this, but even among some of the kids today, even in this area, you don't want to kill that animal. Go to the store and get one that where it doesn't hurt the animal to die. Well, excuse me, but do we not get this process? Meat comes from animals. For us to eat meat, there must be a death. Simple as that. We don't understand that. We've separated ourselves from that whole process. Mm-hmm. We've made it nice and clean and wonderful and sanitized. Unless you've ever been to a butchering place or a... And I have friends who've worked in a couple of them, and it's not pretty, the way we handle and we treat our animals. It's not okay. In fact, it's not kosher. Did you know that by kosher law you have to treat the animal well? The animal must be taken care of, not hurt, not crowded, not... There's rules and laws that they've put into place in order to handle the animals, where we treat an animal with respect, because this is a creation of God, as we are a creation of God. An animal is not to suffer in its death, ever. If you slit the throat right, the animal bleeds out very quickly, and it's considered a probably more painless death than most. But it's got to be done right. If it's done wrong, it's not good. It's not fun. But we've separated all that. The temple didn't do that. You brought the animal, you put your hand on the head of that animal. Your hand. You're identifying with this animal. This is me, this is mine, this is of me, this is a part of me. And you slit the throat of that animal, and then the priest takes the blood. It's said in Talmudic tradition that a lot of people couldn't do it. That they would stand there with their head on the animal and they would begin to weep. And the grown men would fall on their faces weeping before the Lord, recognizing our sin, recognizing our place, recognizing the price of the presence of God. Sometimes I wonder, do we recognize the price of the presence of God, and are we willing to do what that's going to take? I don't know. I've read one commentary that takes this from the perspective of the very first of the offerings that are offered being the most important, because they are the ones that are burned up fully, to the least. That we start with the higher priced and go to the least priced. and back and forth and three or four different directions. And it's interesting because they're all a little different. There's basically three types of offerings that are mentioned here in this passage. There are others. Okay? There are others. We don't take just the one passage and figure out this is exactly how it's done. Because in each passage, a little bit angle, a different angle is taught, a different understanding, a different direction. One of the things I love about learning all of this and learning Hebrew is that it doesn't stay at one level. It keeps going and going and going, and the more I study, the more I know I don't know, and the deeper I need to go, and the more I need to get, and it's addicting, by the way. If you get started doing it, it's addicting, but it's a good addiction. It's good for us. It's good for us to understand and recognize what God really wants. We have three basic offerings here, although broken down into different parts, because we've got the animal and we've got the grain, right? But the animal and grain offerings can be used in the same way, in similar ways. We've got... It doesn't always explain it in this passage who gets to eat which, but it makes a difference which offering is eaten by whom. Mm-hmm. We've got it with one of the first offerings, the Ola, which is a burnt offering, which really, that's a really a terrible translation. We call it a burnt offering, but really it's an offering that's offered up. The Ola, that which is raised up. And it is taken in whole to God. Now, I want you to notice something. Unlike the pagan temples, the offering is not taken out of the visual presence of the person who brought the offering. In the pagan temples, the priests would take the offering, take it out of the physical presence and tell them they fed God. Or they would leave it there, and overnight the priests would take it, leave the fruit cores and whatever, and tell the people their God came and ate. Our God doesn't eat. He is not human like we are in that aspect. And so the offering never leaves the sight of the person bringing the offering. So they know we're not feeding God, but we are giving to Him. The Ola, the burnt offering, it is burnt up whole. Every part of it is burned on the altar. Every part. It's very costly to do that. So if you can't afford to give the full animal, then they've got smaller parts of animals. You can bring the flock, from the flock, a sheep or goat. If you can't do that, then you can bring a dove. If you can't do that, then you can bring a handful of grain. You see, God isn't excluding anybody. But this is a gift given entirely to God, wholly to God, wholly to God. The next one that's talked about it is a shalem. This is one, it's a peace offering. It's called a peace offering or a fellowship offering. In chapter 3 it talks about a fellowship offering. And what's that about? It's making peace between people. It's making peace between us and God in a different way. In this one, the meat is eaten. Some of it is eaten by the Kohanim, or the priests. Some of it is eaten by the person who brings it. And shared with your whole family. It's like we're bringing this, the fat, the entrails, that's going up to God. And the rest of it, we are having a meal with God. A fellowship meal. Then the chatat, which is a sin offering, when we've transgressed, some of that is burned up, but that is eaten only by the kohanim. Cannot be eaten by the person who brings it. We do not benefit from the sacrifice for our sin. Priests do. They get to eat it as representation of God. Three different kinds of offering. The ola is voluntary. It's not a requirement. It's voluntary. So is the shalamin offering. It's voluntary. You can choose what you want to give to God. You can choose if you want to walk in friendship and fellowship with God. The chatat is not voluntary. It's required. It's mandatory. if we have sinned, if we have violated, that is mandatory. Think about the chatat. The very first sin was eating from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, right? We ate something we were not supposed to eat. It didn't belong to us. It belonged to God. In a sense, when we bring a chatat offering, we're giving it back to God. Something that we would eat, but we're not going to. We give it to God. And the priests in God's place eat it. It's part of their food, part of how they are fed. There's rules about how long it can be there. It has to be eaten within a certain length of time or burned up. It doesn't leave the temple. It does not leave the temple or the tabernacle. It belongs solely to God. When we ate the fruit, we kind of crossed a line, right? When we have a relationship with someone, and I say, I have a kind of standard rule in my family, you know. Don't call me before, I live by a 9-to-9 rule. Don't call me before 9 or after 9. Unless someone is bleeding, and if they're not bleeding, they will be soon. Okay, there are times people violate that rule, and I kind of, okay, Lord, you know. But 9-to-9, that's kind of my rule. And to violate that kind of is a transgression against me, isn't it not? It shows a lack of respect. If I've set up a rule, and it's a simple thing, just 9-to-9, please let me get my coffee before you call and talk to me. Maybe I'll be nicer to you that way. please don't call me after I've gotten ready for bed and I'm laying down trying to relax to go to sleep. Mm-hmm. Right? Respect me in this, please. Right? When we violate, when we cross a line, it's as if we've shown a disrespect. When they ate of the fruit, it's as if they disrespected God. When we violate God's commandments, we disrespect God. When we disrespect someone, we have to pay for that. Towards the end, it talks about if you've transgressed against someone. If you've transgressed, when you pay back, you pay back. Not only do you pay back what you stole, but you pay back more than what you stole, right? Mm-hmm. We're making amends, in a sense. So the least I can do if I've violated, if I've disrespected, is to show you respect by paying you back. Mm-hmm. Okay? Right. But our relationship with God isn't just about paying respect and paying him back because he's been disrespected. It's also about a fellowship walk with God, right? And that's the shalamim. That's the fellowship offering. Actually, it's called a zavav shalamim. And the first time these are mentioned, we see a shalamim is actually in the bread, in the covenant that takes place between God and Israel at Sinai. A fellowship offering. Do you remember where they went? It says the elders gathered up and they saw as if it were the throne of God, and they saw the floor. They had a fellowship meal with God. They ate with God. We have a zavrek, which is the covenant meal made by Yaakov and Laban. So really what this is talking about, this is a covenant fellowship meal. This is a covenant fellowship time. We are making peace with each other. We are making covenant with each other, with God. When we share it, it's a little bit different than saying, I'm sorry I messed up, let me pay you back. It's more along the lines of, I want to be a friend. Let's make a friendship. Let's make a relationship. And that becomes more about love. Love each other. It's a covenant. So basically the shalamim is let's share. The one is paying back, the other is let's share it, okay? It's respect and it's relationship. The olah is a little bit different. I've been going backwards here again, right? The very first one that is mentioned is the olah offering. It's consumed completely on the offering, on the altar. It's gone. It's burned up. The first olah that's mentioned in Torah is where Abraham takes Isaac up to the mountain. This is where that which belongs to me, it is mine, it's really mine, is given to God. Because guess what? I love him so much that I'm willing to give of what is mine to him. I mean, honestly, didn't he give it to us to begin with? So there's a sense in which it is his anyway, but it's a whole different offering. It's more along the lines of, God, you are so wonderful. You deserve all of it. All of it. I'm not paying you back for anything. I'm not trying to be friends. You are so worthy of it. You deserve all of it. It's a whole different relationship. I think we as many people as Christians, we want to be friends with God. We want the fellowship with God. But do we have the awe of God? Do we recognize who he really is? Or is he still veiled to us? See, God will show you as much of himself as you can handle. Reality. God loves us so much. It's not his desire to show up and have us all be consumed. If he wanted to do that, it would be done. Right? His desire is for love. He loves us. He cares about us. He wants us to have relationship with him. But when we really see who he is fully, it's like, how can I hold anything back from you? How could I hold anything back? I can't. Three different kinds of relationship that we can have with God. But do we know what it costs? You see, in each one of the sacrifices, whichever one it is, if it involves an animal, it involves laying your hands on that animal. It involves, this is me, putting yourself into that animal. It involves taking and slitting the throat yourself. Because God's enemy is death. Do I understand how it is that blood cleanses that? I don't. I really don't. I don't get it. Don't understand it at all. And if someone tries to tell you they do understand it, then maybe they need to try to study it a little bit more. Because there's just no comprehending all of that that I have found. I haven't found anyone who's a true scholar who will say they really, really, really understand it. But what I have found is that we do understand is that this is what we need. See, it's God's world, not ours. He made a world for us that we can dwell in, that's healthy for us, that's safe for us. And he put us on it. He doesn't need to be on earth. In order for him to be on earth, there has to be change. There has to be something different. There has to be, it has to function by his being, not ours. The tabernacle, the temple, is just such a place. It has to function by his being, not ours. It functions by what he has said. This is what needs to happen. I can understand some of it. I can get a little bit of it. Do I know how blood cleanses? I don't know. What I've noticed here, did you notice that none of these actually cleanse the human being? They cleanse the temple. There's a reason for that. You know, there's a place that God says, I don't delight in sacrifice. I want obedience. I want obedience. This is not my joy. This wasn't what I loved. I need obedience. Hebrews tells us that these sacrifices never took away our sin. Never. Not once did this series of sacrifices take our sin away from us. They couldn't do it. That's not what they were for anyway. They were for carving out a place that the Shekinah glory of God could dwell on the earth. There's only one sacrifice that takes away the sin of the world. From time before to time in the end, God never, never said that these sacrifices were to make us right. There's only one sacrifice that does that. There's only one that brings us back. He's always promised through all of this to give us a new heart. How does he do that? Through Yeshua, through salvation. From the day before the world was created, God knew. Before he even created day, he knew. Time is our construct. God created it for us. He doesn't need time. He doesn't. He knew before the foundation of the earth what was going to happen. He knew that you were going to be born. He knew about you. The word says so. He knew about Adam and Eve. He knew about the sin. He knew about it. From before the world was born. And it says of Yeshua, the Lamb slain before the beginning of the world. And I've read and I've heard and I know it's taught that all of time built up to this and this cross changed everything. Well, guess what? Yes, it does. But God has never changed. It didn't change at the cross. It changed because of the cross. It wasn't in time that the change took place. The Lamb was slain before the foundation of the world. God doesn't dwell in time. So all of these before are looking forward to salvation through Yeshua, the same as all of us after are looking back at salvation from Yeshua. It's not about what we do. It's about Yeshua and his righteousness and his standing before God and who he is. It's about him. Our righteousness is as filthy rags, according to Isaiah. And that word filthy rags refers to the cloths that were used for a woman's menses. That's what our righteousness is. And a woman's menses is representative in the tabernacle and in the covenant discussion as that which is unclean. Make that connection. It's not just that it's kind of icky or whatever, you know. It's that it's unclean. Unclean. Our righteousness is unclean. It's not enough. But him. He takes us, and he makes us righteous. Our righteousness is as filthy rags, but for him. But for him. He will make us white as snow before God. Because we stand in his righteousness. None of these sacrifices were about our standing in righteousness. These were all about having a place where God's Shekinah glory could dwell. Has the earth changed yet? No. It hasn't. Do you know something interesting? When Ezekiel talks about the reign of Messiah, when the prophets talk about Messiah, son of David, sitting on the throne of Israel, it also talks about the sacrificial system. Ezekiel sees a temple. And he sees the prince in the temple. And he describes the temple. That temple has not been built. The temple that the Temple Institute out of Israel today is planning to build is not Ezekiel's temple. They want to build a replica of Solomon's temple. Not Ezekiel's. They don't want to do Herod's. They have it in place, by the way. They have the stone altar ready to go. They've shown it. They displayed it at Hanukkah. I watched as they walked through a water purification system, a water purification ritual as they would have done. It's on video. Go to thetempleinstitute.org and you can see all this stuff. It's really interesting. They're ready. They have the high priest's garments ready. They have it planned. They know what they need. They have a menorah ready. They have an altar, the incense altar ready. They have a table of showbread ready. You can go to Jerusalem and walk through their little displays. It'll show you all these parts they've got for the temple ready to go. All they need is permission.
At this point, that's all they need. At this point, they can't even pray on Temple Mount without getting arrested. Doesn't matter what the court said. High court said they could pray. High court said you can't stop them from praying. The court said that, but the police on Temple Mount are still not honoring that. They're ready, guys. Mm-hmm. My question is, are we? Mm-hmm. Are we ready for what it's going to take? A lot of people think Yeshua is going to come. He's going to come, and it's going to be all love and dovey and wonderful and sweet. And I like to know what Bible they're reading, because I read the book of Revelation, and it says he comes with a sword. He comes with pestilence. He comes with violence. Do we see pestilence around us? Do we see violence around us? Do we not realize this is happening? It's all around us. How many of you were aware of the solar eclipse? Yeah. I know if you've been here, you're aware of it, because I told you about it. Did anybody besides me set their alarm and get up? Yes. I set my alarm. I got up 3 o'clock in the morning. It was early. I went online. I watched prayers at the wall. I read the prayer that was presented. I said, Lord, I don't know what you're doing, but you're doing something. I've read the books on the blood moons. If you have, that's great, wonderful. If you go see the movie that John Hagee's done, I will tell you right now, I disagree with some of his conclusions. Okay, I do. I disagree with some of his conclusions. But that's okay. The idea is getting out there. The recognition is there. The God is doing something in the heavens. They are there for signs and wonders. Is he ready for us to have the temple in Jerusalem yet? Are we ready for Messiah to come yet? I don't know. My concern, and I discussed this with someone yesterday on the phone, is my concern is everybody's looking at all of this, and if Yeshua doesn't come at Sukkot or at Feast of Tabernacles this fall, I mean, Feast of Trumpets or Feast of Tabernacles, if he doesn't come at those two times, there are people that are going to go, oh, we must be so stupid. Well, maybe he's not coming. Seventh-day Adventist group talks about the great disappointment, where people had calculated it out. It had been calculated out, knew exactly when Messiah was supposed to come. People sold their lands, went up on a hill, and stood there and waited. Talk about a disappointment. You're expecting God to come before sunrise. What happens when the sun rises? And he's not there. God can do what he wants to do. I can look at this and I can say, I see all the signs and wonders. I see the stars lighting up. I see the blood moons. I see, and I believe, and I will tell you this strongly, the world will not be the same next year this time. How that change is going to take place, I don't know. Is it going to be catastrophic? I don't know. I'm not going to tell you one way. I don't know. People who studied the Word and studied Messiah's coming and did everything as diligently as they could, had their charts on the wall, I like to say. I grew up in a church that had the charts on the wall, the dispensational charts, you know. And this is when the rapture is taking place in so many days, and these things are going to happen in these times. And it was all charted out. It's all on the wall. And I know exactly. I can almost picture it fully today, because I grew up with that on the walls in the Sunday school rooms. The people who did that before Messiah came the first time missed it. He didn't look like what they expected. It didn't function exactly. It didn't happen according to every single little thing they thought was supposed to be there. They didn't read all the prophecies correctly. What makes us think we're better? What gives us such arrogance that we think we've got it all figured out? They had it all figured out and they were wrong. So the way it's all lined up, do I think that Yeshua is coming? Yes. Do I think it will be this Feast of Trumpets? I would love it if it was. Will it be at Sukkot? I don't know. I've taught both. I can teach both sides. It's kind of like the concept of the rapture. I can go to Scripture and I can teach 2 hours on why there will be a rapture. Then I can turn around and teach another 2 hours on why there won't be. You know, it's not clear, guys. And if you think it is, then you're listening to someone that's looking at it with their mindset already. God's going to do what God wants to do. What I'm saying is it's all lining up so that he can do it.
Yeah.
And it looks like it's all lining up.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to come into the kingdom and have to go to Torah 101. I don't want God to have to explain all of it to me. I don't want to have to sit there and I don't want to have to learn it all the hard way. I want to at least have some idea what's happening. Mm-hmm. What are these offerings about? These offerings are about our being able to stand in the presence of a holy and righteous God before the world is recreated. Because you see, Messiah will judge from Israel. He will judge from Israel for a season before the world is recreated and we are all given totally new hearts. What's going to happen during that thousand-year reign, during that time? Well, I don't know. But I know this, there will be a temple. There will be sacrifices at the temple. Post-Yeshua, yes, there will be. Ezekiel says so. He describes it. The whole world will come. Will there be festivals? Absolutely. It says any nation that does not come to Jerusalem for Sukkot will not have rain. That's what it says during the millennial reign, during the reign of Messiah. If a nation does not come up to Jerusalem for Sukkot, that tells me the festivals will still be going, right? Maybe we ought to learn about what they are. That's kind of how this whole ministry got birthed. Because God said these festivals are permanent. He never said they were done away with. Did Yeshua fulfill them? Yes, he did. He showed them to us in their fullness. It doesn't mean he said quit doing it. He never said stop doing it. I can't find any place in the Brit Hadassah, Apostolic Writings, Brit Hadassah, New Testament, whatever you want to call it, find any place where it says quit doing them. This study out of the book of Leviticus on the very first day of the month of Nisan or the month of Aviv, whichever you choose to call it, is an important study. Why? Because this is the first day of the first month of the festival seasons. What's it going to look like? I don't know. But we're starting and we're learning. And I hope you've learned something. It's a little hard to do. It's hard to condense it all. I don't begin to understand or try to do all of that. That's why you got to study it for yourself. Study it for yourself. Look at what it says. Tonight, we're going to have what we call our Birkat HaKodesh, which means blessing the month. That's what Birkat means. It's blessings, plural, Birkat HaKodesh, the month. We are going to gather for a family meal, bring whatever you want to share, as long as it's not pork or shellfish, we're happy. We're not too picky. We'll fellowship together. We'll talk a little bit. We'll enjoy our time together. I know there's a couple people that aren't here today that are planning on coming tonight. Some people that won't be able to be here at all either time. And we're going to talk about the month of Nisan. What is coming up this month? Well, one thing that's coming up this month is Passover. That's in 2 weeks. If you want to be at our Passover Seder, we're going to have a sign-up list tonight. We'll start writing down who's going to be here, what you want to bring. We're limiting it to the first 40 people who sign up, because I'm not moving it this year. And we can't fit more than 40 people in this room. We've tried. It gets very hard. So if you want to come, if you want your family to come, invite them, bring them, but let us know as soon as you can so that you make sure you have a seat available to you. And tonight we're going to talk about the month of Nisan, which is the month of liberation, the month of deliverance. Do you want deliverance? We're going to talk about that tonight. Father, I thank you for today. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you that you've taught us so much. I ask for your blessing upon each one that was here. I ask that you would go with us. I ask that you would take whatever has been said here that is meant for each one, that is from your spirit, and you would cement it in, that you would allow that seed to lay in there and to grow and to plant and to bring forth good fruit. And Father, what's not for them or what's not of you directly, Lord, just let it fall away. Let it go away. Blow it away by your spirit. But that which is of you, let it produce seed. We ask for your blessing as we go out. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach.
The Lord bless you.
The Lord bless you.
And keep you.
And keep you.
The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord bless you.
The Lord bless you.
And keep you.
And keep you.
The Lord make his face to shine upon you. And be gracious unto you. And be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. Shabbat shalom.